The last few videos were already getting really difficult to follow and required a lot of concentration and patience to understand them. So I'm happy that we can now move on to the network challenges from exploit exercises protostar, which will be a lot easier because we have to establish some basics first. Let's have a quick look at networking level 0. The description says you have to convert strings to little endian integers. And this level is very easy, but to fully understand what's going on, the code is not quite enough. I show you why. So main calls a function background process and passes it a name and the user and group ID it will run with. But this function is not a common libc function. You can also check etc passvd for the user ID 999 and you will notice there is no such user. This might seem weird, but just don't think so abstractly about computers. What does it mean to have a user on a Linux system? In the end, a user is just an ID, a number in memory. And for example, an owner of a file just means that this file has this number as owner set. Now, if the user is listed here in etc passvd, Linux will be so nice and display the name instead of the number, but under the hood it's still just an integer. So even though there is no name assigned to that ID, you are still free to use it. Anyway, back to the code. The other functions such as serveForever and setIO are also not known functions. And when you look at the includes, you will notice that it references a common.c file. So the author of this challenge implemented a lot of code in a different file and we don't know what it does. But one function is here and that is the run function. You can see that it is called at the end of main. Run generates a random number, tells us that you should send that number as little endian, then performs a read from a file descriptor, in this case from standard input, interprets this input as a number and compares it if it's the same as the random number before. So, just a simple test. As I said earlier, we could solve the challenge without knowing these unknown functions below, because just reading the comments and function names tells you everything you need to know. But as you know, we are not satisfied on this channel when we ignore underlying concepts. We want to understand computers better, and these functions implemented two interesting concepts that are mentioned here. One is running the process as a daemon, and the other one is about networking and sockets. So, how can we figure out what it does? Well, we know already everything we need to be able to reverse engineer this. So let's start by exploring the behavior of the program before digging deeper. When you try to run the program, nothing happens. But when you look at the running processes, you can see that net0 is already running. So let's quickly switch to the root user so we can kill that process and start it ourselves. The default root password for this VM is god mode. Now, we can kill net0 and we can verify that it's not running anymore. So let's execute it again. Nothing happens. But if we check the processes, we can see that it's running again. So what happened? Let's kill it again and start it with strace. So it finishes with an exit. But what happens before? It seems to open a net0.pid file with write permissions. Then it changes the user and group ID to 999, with set effective UID and GID, so this means the process drops its root permissions. After that, it calls clone. The man page says that clone creates a new process similar to fork. So this will spawn a new process as clone, a copy of itself. And the return value is the process ID of the new process, which is equal to the value written into the PID file. So that file just helps you to keep track of the new process you created. And after that, the parent process exits and leaves the child process orphaned. This is literally referred to as an orphan process, and because we did this intentionally, we also refer to this now as a daemon. It's now a background process. So what we can do is we can run strace with the minus f flag to follow child processes created instead of staying in the parent process. When we do that, we see that after the clone, we attach to the new process and in the background, the old process exits. Then we change directory and open up dev null, which is another special pseudo file that acts like a black hole. And then we dub the std input, std output, and std error of this process, which basically means we bend all these standard streams to point into the black hole. Basically, we just throw away everything. And then we write the child process's ID to the PID file from earlier, which had the file descriptor number 3. Now the fun part starts. A new socket is created. A socket is used for network communications, and you can choose what kind of socket you want with those flags and settings. But most importantly is then the call to bind, which attempts to bind this process here to the port 2999, which means that if the operating system receives a packet that wants to establish a connection with this process, it will do so and then forward the packet with the data inside to the process. But this function call fails because the address and port is already in use by another process, which makes sense because we called net0 already earlier. So let's kill the process again and retry this. Okay, this looks great. Now we listen on the port we opened and we are waiting for a packet to arrive with the accept syscall. So let's open a second terminal and use netstat to find this listening process. And here it is. On port 2999, the process net0 is listening. Cool. Now let's use netcat to establish a TCP connection with this port. This will cause the accept call to return because a new connection got established, and immediately after accept you see another call to clone, which creates another process to now handle the server client connection. This way another user can also establish a connection and doesn't have to wait until you are done, because you have now your own dedicated process. Also, accept returned a new file descriptor that references the socket. So, like with regular files, you can now perform read and write with these file descriptors, like you would do with any other file. The kernel underneath makes sure to send the data you write as a TCP packet to the client, and when it receives data, it will make sure that you can read it from the socket. Now, it will change the standard input and output and error streams from def null to this new file descriptor, and the program can then just read from standard input and will read the data you send it. And that is what the run function does. If you compare run with the last two syscall, we first have to write to stdio, which came from the printf here, and then an fread from standard input. This is where we are right now. When we now type a line into netcat, netcat will send a packet with this text through the network to the program, the server. And on the server side, you can see that it read that string you sent to it and then performed the write telling you that it's the wrong number. That's the failed printf in run. So let's summarize what the hidden code is doing. It first daemonizes by cloning itself and killing the parent to become an orphan, and then it starts listening on port 2999 for TCP connections. Once a connection is established, and we will have a detailed look at the TCP protocol some other time, it will create another process, a clone of the process, to handle this established connection, while the parent is ready again to accept another connection in parallel. The child process that handles the connection is now basically just calling run. So in simple terms, you can say the program runs as a background process that executes run for every client that connects to it. Awesome, we understood that. Now let's solve the challenge. First of all, we need to get the string representation of that number. We can use Python for that, specifically the struct package, which we already used before. So with struct.pack, we can convert a number to the byte string representation. But as you can see, the resulting string doesn't use characters we can type with the keyboard. We can print these byte values with echo and minus e, but simply piping this into netcat doesn't work because the number is randomized. But we can use a simple trick. We can use echo minus e, but inside of the quotes, we use backticks to execute cat with a minus, which simply redirects anything we type to the output again, and the output is then placed in the quotes of echo. So when we now pipe that into netcat, we see the number and cat is waiting for input. We use Python to convert the number, and then we simply paste the escape string back into the other terminal, hit enter, and then use Control D to indicate that we are done with the input, which closes cat and echo will send the string to netcat. And that works. We get the success message. Thank you, sir, madam.